All right, welcome everyone. Thank you for joining us for this week's office hours today. We are here to share some topics that have been coming up in communications with districts regarding our remote summative proctoring tool, as well as remote summative administration, and also in-person administration too. Let's not forget about that for Smarter Balanced and NGSS. We will also have some reminders about testing students who might be special population students. Please use the question feature of the GoToMeeting. If you have questions, we will try to address them as we go. And at the end, if we haven't addressed them all, we will, like we always do in the office hours, we probably will handle them via audio. Don't forget to mute your microphones, and please be aware this is being recorded. And if you're looking for the handout that's driving this week's presentation, it is in the handout section of the GoToWebinar. So who's on the call? Good afternoon, my name is Abe Chris. I'm joined here this afternoon by my colleagues, some of whom will be presenting, some of whom are also just on the call. Deirdre Ducharme and Janet Stuck are here. Deirdre and Janet work on our special populations and accommodations. Also on the call, Jeff Gregg, who works on NGSS and CTAS. We're also joined by folks in our office, Christy Alberino, who works on really all of our assessments, but this time of year, Smarter Balanced and our interims, and also handles most of our appeals that go through these days. Also on the call, Michelle Rosado, who's our SAT school day program manager, also among other things, and then also attending to facilitating this webinar here today. So thanks, Michelle, for making that happen. And then Marlene Shamroy, who supports all of us, including the districts, is on the call as well. So thanks for everybody from CSDE. Also on the call is from Cambium, our assessment vendor, Amber Benlian, Jen Cho, and Marie Musumeci. We have their contact here. This is really old news, but always keep it on hand because you never know when you need to contact the help desk. This contact information here, the number and the email. So before we jump into some details this week, we wanted to give you an update on testing as of 5 a.m. on April 21st. This is the progress that some of the districts across our state have made already. About 14,000 tests have been started already for Smarter Balanced, 12,000 for NGSS, and then for CTAS and CTAA, you can see those that have been started and then those that have completed. So testing season is in full swing. The window runs until June 4th at this moment, but we're going to watch these numbers climb pretty steadily. I know some districts are still on vacation this week, but we anticipate over the next couple of weeks things are really going to heat up. Our busiest testing weeks always seem to be in the May 9th, 10th area, so we know that at that point there's going to be a lot of testing going on. So some of you who are on the call might be some of these participants here. So so about the agenda, we're going to talk a little bit about administration expectations, special pops, then some key policy questions that we have run through in previous weeks. And some of these slides are redundant, but we found that there's a lot of folks who are still catching up on some of the aspects about remote testing. So we will be hitting on the important policy questions, and then also resources for supporting remote testing. And then obviously we'll do a little questions at the end. If you have missed office hours in the past, no worries. We did a big office hours on April 8th, and then on April 15th, really focused exclusively on remote proctoring. So you can find those if you go to the Connecticut Comprehensive Portal here under training materials, and then under training modules, training courses, you can find the actual office hours recordings. So if you missed anything or need to share this with your colleagues in the district, you can find this information here, the office hours from the 8th and the 15th of April that we did in the last couple of weeks. All right, so a little bit about administration expectations. A lot has been said about our remote administration, but remember, for Smarter Balance and NGSS, keep in mind, think about location, location, location. If a student is in school with an in-person proctor, they still should be tested in person. This looks like things have all the way we've always tested our students in school. However, if a student is fully remote but can come into school in a safe location, they should all be also be tested in person. We've heard different things from districts. Some districts are having great success pulling their remote learners into test in person. Some not so much. Again, there should be at least an opportunity given for those remote learners. However, if you can do it, we fully understand this year the safety of staff, students, communities is number one. And if they can't make it in, then no worries. But then that's where the third option would come into play, where if a student is fully remote, they would be tested remotely. So how about our alternate assessments? There is no remote proctoring tool for the alternates. Keep that in mind. We've been saying that since, gosh, I think in January. And then all students eligible for the alternate tested must be in person in school, or if a trained TA is available at an alternate secure location. Again, so that alternate location would really be only if a trained TEA is available. Okay, so testing devices, just some reminders, all devices, whether used for remote or in person, must have the secure browser, mobile or kiosk app installed. This is required for test security. Again, this is the third week we've been covering this. There's still some districts out there that are still picking up on this. We do want to mention that this is for test security. We're not doing this to make your lives challenging, but this is just an important aspect of security and monitoring for NGSS and Smarter Balance. Don't forget that BYOD devices can be used as long as the secure browser or the mobile app is installed. No problem on that. Just make sure that the secure browser or mobile app is on. And then also make sure that the student's computer has any necessary assistive technology such as text-to-speech software or screen readers that might be needed. Okay, so how about proctor options? We've had a lot of questions about the best way to proctor tests in a district, and you know every district is different, obviously. And so although some of the themes have come up, there are some commonalities. One thing to keep in mind is other district personnel may be used as proctors for both in-person and remote test administration. So as long as they're properly trained, that's fine. You can a para might be a test proctor just as long as they're trained, or a substitute teacher potentially. Don't forget, you might want to try to consider training select staff. We've heard some districts having staff focusing on remote learners, while some students might be focusing on in-person learners. It's another thing we've heard that has worked well for proctor options. You can also have students tested, not necessarily with their normal teacher. The student might be tested in another group for other reasons. Then finally, don't forget to consolidate. You can consolidate your groups. And what we mean by that is if you have two in-person sessions running, for instance, with maybe 10 and 10, maybe those students are combined because those classrooms have remote learners. You can combine those classrooms. When you combine those classrooms, you have a 20 count, but then that also saves that proctor to maybe do some remote administration. And then after all, don't worry, you still have plenty of time. The window doesn't close until June 4th. And we've also been recommending to the extent that you can, we are appreciative of the fact that the planning of the planning that's necessary to get remote proctoring done, but we're really advocating trying to wait till the end of the window. So if there's the possibility that students will be coming in, they can be tested in person, which is really the ideal scenario. Don't forget about proctor training. A remote testing training course is available and is highly encouraged for test administrators administering remote assessments. It isn't mandatory, but is highly, highly encouraged. It's a 30-minute training course, and it offers all the relevant training to log into the test, working with students, so on and so forth. And don't forget the test administration manual. This manual is important this year. I know we found in past years, the standard in-person manual, people have become more accustomed to the protocols, the practices, but all new protocols this year are many new protocols. So please pay attention to the remote test administration manual. It's going to help you succeed with your remote administrations. Okay, so where do I find my materials for to support remote testing? We've sent a lot of emails out in terms of to DAs letting you know, but if you haven't seen this, really you're going to go to the comprehensive portal. Under resources, you're going to click on remote administration. When you click on remote administration, you'll see these options here, and so you can pull up the remote summative resources as well as the training resources and so on. So at the end of this presentation, we'll kind of dive down a little bit deeper in terms of what is actually in these folders, but this is where you would find the stuff if you haven't located just yet. Okay, I'm gonna turn it hopefully over to Janet, and Janet's gonna pick up and run with a few slides here. Janet, you wanna take over for a few?
Thanks, Dave. So we wanted to share a little bit of reminders in terms of the remote proctoring. Just like our in-school assessments, we want proctors to be actively monitoring the process. So in terms of the remote proctoring, you would use a secure classroom management system such as Google Classroom to prepare remote testers. And you would be providing them their session IDs, their SASID numbers, and other details the teacher needs to communicate prior to logging in. And these are defined in the test administration manual. And this includes reading the required script that's in Appendix D of the remote proctoring test manual. The students need to close all programs before accessing the secure browser because they will be shut down with the secure browser. So students' cameras must remain on continuously during the entire test session. If for some reason the camera malfunctions or is suddenly not available, if the student turns it off, you should pause the test session and wait until the camera is functioning properly or available for the testing. Students are, of course, not allowed to use non-authorized electronic devices within the remote proctoring environment. So you need to be very aware of their desk area as you're monitoring. And students should have access to the required materials described in the manual, such as scratch paper and a writing utensil or any non-embedded designated supports and accommodations that are established for students with IEPs or Section 504 plans. Next slide, please. So within the remote proctoring testing, there are proctor tools, communication tools that are critical to help the student function in the testing environment. So teachers can broadcast messages to students and they pop up automatically. The student does not have to do anything at all. We want to make sure that the teachers keep the messages brief. They use the text-to-speech technology to provide those messages. And students can respond to teachers through this communication method as well in the chat feature. Teachers may start one-to-one video conferencing with a student to support them. And there's even access to a screen sharing feature to help the student with any technological or understanding as long as it's not related to the content itself. Next slide, please. So we also wanted to remind you that this is going to be critical in terms of setting the remote proctor indicator in TIDE. You'll see in the student profile the remote proctoring indicator here at the bottom, and this needs to be set if the student is participating in testing remotely. And you can upload this information in the remote proctoring summative TAM. There are specific directions about uploading this information. You can even upload it as a group. Next slide, please. So we strongly encourage districts to administer practice tests both in person and especially in remote, because it allows students to become familiar with the testing environment and the universal tools and supports or accommodations if the student is using those as well. And this is also a nice opportunity to orient the student to the process during the remote administration, and you can include parents and guardians in the process so they know exactly what to be expected in the testing environment. Next slide, please. So we have mentioned this before, but we wanted to remind you that non-embedded designated supports and accommodations need to be attended to by the district, particularly for remote students. They would be set and tied, but if the student is remote, you need to have a district policy about how some of these supports are provided, and we have documentation about how they are not available for a remote session depending on what the accommodation or designated support is. Particularly, for example, like read aloud is not available in the remote environment. And you can upload these designated supports and accommodations in TIDE, and you can check to see them and download that information to support your proctors, making sure all of those are provided at the time of testing. Next slide, please. So we've had several communications from districts about, in this new testing dynamic, what does a small group setting mean? So it's defined by the purpose for the small group. And this is for students, generally it is smaller than typical class size. That's the very base definition. And then it's also based on whether an accommodation is required. And the size of the group depends on if it's the student is being tested remotely. We have a maximum of 10. That's our recommendation, because when you get beyond 10 in a remote setting, it's very difficult to monitor and provide the support you need, the students need in the remote environment when you have more than 10 students. So how is this determined in terms of the group size? So generally teachers working closely with students should be able to determine their needs and the requirements for each individual student. And this, the expectation is that this information would be shared with the district administrator for testing, who sets up the schedules and groupings for testing. We've also made recommendations in terms of, if you know you have a student who is highly anxious or very disruptive, you can make a group setting of one for that particular student, to ensure that other students are not disrupted for their testing as well. And again, some accommodations are predetermined to require group settings of one, and examples such as a human reader would be something like that, because you need that one-to-one attention to meet the student's need and not to disrupt other students. Within a remote setting, the teacher would have access to just the teacher, so that less than 10 students, 10 or less would be most appropriate for those students. That would be the group size. And we also want to encourage you, again, to use the practice test as an opportunity to determine if the group size needs to be adjusted in your planning. Next slide, please. So we've shared these resources before, but we continue to get calls about our alternate assessment students. And you may recall that the alternate eligibility form must be submitted in order for a student to be able to access the alternate assessments. In order for the eligibility form to be submitted, the teacher must participate in required training, and that's annually, and that teacher must pass the associated quiz. So we're getting calls now about not being able to access the test, and often that is because the eligibility form was submitted after the due date. And you may remember or take note that if the eligibility form is submitted after the due date, which was February 15th, that TEA must call the CAI help desk and request that the alternate assessment indicator be set to yes. If it's not, then the teacher will not be able to access the secure materials, submit anything into the data entry interface, or access the CTAA. Next slide, please. We also wanted to remind you of the resources that we have available for special populations. You'll see the dark blue band at the top of the portal. There's a drop-down menu under resources, and there are several accessibility and special populations resources, those related to alternate assessment, and many brochures and quick guides to help you with understanding those functionings of certain processes within the testing environment. Okay, Abe, back to you.
Yeah. All right, sounds good, Janet. Thank you. Thank you, Janet. I appreciate it. So we're gonna bounce back to remote, actually. And so I see some of you asking questions in the question box. Please keep them coming, and thanks to everybody who's responding. I know the CAI team has been responding to them, as well as some of the CSDE team. So if you have questions, please send them in. We wanted to hit some of the key, you know, and these have been circulated, I believe, on some of the previous office hours. But because they have come up so frequently, we're repeating some of these again, and they're really important answers or questions and answers to make remote proctoring successful. So like key remote proctoring policy questions. So let's look at some of these. So is there a max group size? Yes, we are recommending 10. From a technical perspective, there really is no limit. It's only limited by the internet bandwidth. However, due to the attentiveness required for monitoring and potential student support that is needed, we're recommending this 10 amount. We didn't pull this out of thin air, rather it was born from our pilot as well as what other states are doing. So again, recommendation of 10. If you have to exceed it, please proceed with caution. Are students required to use a secure browser? I think we've answered that several times. Yes, the answer is yes. Moving up here now, what are the next steps for situations in which a test administrator is reporting a test irregularity, impropriety, or a breach? We should really refer to the test administration manual. If you have any questions, reach out to us at that email here, the ctstudentassessment@ct.gov, or our 713-6860 number. This is a biggie here. Can I start a test session in one location and complete the test session in another location? So in other words, go from remote to in-person. For Smarter Balance, you can do that, for Smarter Balance, you can cross locations, but remember, if a student moves from remote to in-person, you still have to adjust their indicator and tide in terms of in-person and remote. For NGSS, though, there are different forms across remote and in-person, so it is imperative that testing be completed in the mode in which it was started for NGSS. So if, for instance, a student started in school, and then were to go home for one reason or another, you would want to wait to have that student tested when they get back, or otherwise they're going to be starting a new form. Okay, we have one more page of critical questions, I believe. Can a test administrator administer a remote and in-person testing session simultaneously? This is possible when administering the interim assessments, but not recommended for summative testing, since monitoring both environments would be a challenge. Again, this falls along the line of the Max 10 recommendation, where you could conceivably do it, but it would require someone to be extremely attentive, set up multiple sessions, not recommended. Can students located in person be administered tests with the remote indicator on using the remote administration tool? That is a big no. The CSDE, we are tracking where students are taking the tests for reporting purposes. So simply put, in-person students should be administered tests in the traditional manner in school. Students who are in a room with a proctor in the same room, regardless of their mode of learning, are tested in person. Students who are not in the same space as the proctor, for whatever reason, are tested as remote students, and the remote indicator must be set to yes for these students. Does anything need to be activated and tied? Janet touched on this. Yes, students must have the remote proctoring indicator set to yes. That has to be done for a remote proctoring test. And then this language about sharing session IDs and student SASIDs in a secure manner. Don't forget, SASIDs should be not shared via personal email or text. There should be a sure, secure means used to share those. Keep in mind also that the session ID is not secure, so information can be shared via email or text at the time of testing with the session ID, or if you're sharing the session ID. Okay, so how about resources that are out there? What's out there for remote proctoring? Again, this is, we're covering some of the news that we had put out the last few weeks, but we're finding that some folks have not caught up with some of these resources. So first thing is for coordinators, teachers, and proctors is the TAM, which is a required resource that outlines all the key policies, protocols, and communication features for testing, and includes proctor scripts to be provided at the time of testing. Again, as I mentioned earlier, your proctors really want to be familiar with that. Then there's a user guide for teachers administering Smarter Balance and NGSS, which is a recommended resource. It provides teachers with the key steps and an overview of communication features for remote testing. And then a quick guide for teachers to start or schedule Smarter Balanced and NGSS and NGS interim and summative assessments. How about for technology coordinators? There's the quick guide for technology coordinators that provides all the general background for tech coordinators. And then how about remote proctoring resources for testing coordinators, teachers, and proctors? There's the remote FAQ, which we are updating periodically. If you haven't seen the most recent one, we updated one on April 14th. That's got about 5 or 6 new questions that have been added. Then there's the recommended training course that we've mentioned. Again, highly recommended. It's about 30 minutes. It's worth the investment. This is of particular interest, actually, too, because if you have new people who have entered into, new users entered into TIE, just recently, so for instance, in a week or so, you have a new user. The user, in order to test remotely, will either have to take this course or you'll have to contact the help desk, so to add them for remote proctoring. So keep that in mind. New users into TIDE, you will have to add the remote testing flag for them or take the training course. And then don't forget the remote testing considerations. For non-embedded universal tools, designated supports, and accommodations provides teachers and administrators with information regarding students who may need the provision of external materials to access assessments during remote admin. Okay, how about for parents and guardians? There's the checklist and the agreement, which has been translated into six languages listed here. There's the guide for families and also a FAQ for parents and guardians and a sample parent guardian letter. Again, these are all on the resource, the remote admin resource page that we listed before. It's important, sorry, going back and forth here. It's important to note that these checklists and the agreement can be used as a guide for district local implementation. So for instance, the checklist can be customized to something that would work better for your district, but just should contain the same messaging. It can be used as a model, in other words. There's also some videos that are out there. I'm not going to go through all the videos. I will mention the one in particular that was just released. The how students log in to take a test at home video. One of the biggest concerns is the period of time in which students log in to the secure browser, and during that period of time are asked to select the test, complete a camera check and microphone check, and also wait for approval to access the test. This is the period where there is no communication with with teachers or test proctors. And there was a large concern about, you know, having students be successful to get through this period. And there has been a video that's been created that can be found under the remote training resources folder that we had touched on earlier under remote resources. And it's the second one down here, the how students log in to take a test at home. Again, we just released that, I want to say late last week. So be mindful that that's out there. Again, it's going to help students get through that process from the point at which they enter their SACID test session ID and first name, and when they get back together with the test proctor or the teacher after they've done these camera checks and selected the test and so forth. Okay, so we're at the point in which we went a little bit over, but that's okay. We're at the point in which we will take questions either through the question box, or we can answer them verbally, or we'll type them back to you. So what I'm gonna do is, I don't see any questions that have come in. I'm gonna wait a minute here. Looks like all the questions that have come in have been answered and broadcast to the webinar here. So I'm gonna give about 30 seconds or a minute, and please type your questions in. Can you repeat this? New users into Tide who will do remote proctoring will have to complete the training test or call the help desk to have them set up. Yeah, good point. So thanks for the email. So, and Jen, I'm gonna lean on you here for a second. What the timing is? When is the full sweep being done, Jen? Can you remind me when those?
Tomorrow night, we are going to do another review of all the users in Tide. And if they do not have the remote certification flag set, we will set it for them. So starting next week, if you are adding a brand new user into Tide, they will either need to, and they're going to administer the remote test, they either need to take the remote certification course, or they need to call the help desk and ask that the certification flag be set for the user.
Thanks, Jen. Yeah, so starting next week, that's particularly important. Thanks for clarifying. Okay, so another question came in. We had a student that entered our school in November. They weren't in Tide. We called Tide. They said to send them again. Do you know what that means? This is a pretty nuanced one. They were in PSIS, and there is no way to send them, I'm aware. So if you have any questions about specific examples like this, you know who you are who asked that, email me or email CT Student Assessment. Generally speaking, if a student is in, actually not generally speaking, except for some very, very unusual exceptions, if a student is in PSIS, they should be in TIDE. So I'm not sure what was going on in that instance, but we'll resolve that for you. So please email me or CT Student Assessment or anyone else, you know, anyone else on the webinar, that we can all help you out. Thanks. Okay, I'll give it another 20 seconds here. Okay, so thank you for attending. I don't see any more questions piling. We really appreciate your attending the office hours today. As a reminder, we will be conducting these every Thursday at 3 o'clock from now until the end of testing. We appreciate things you can, we appreciate the thank you here to comments. Thank you for thanking us. We will be here again next week, same time. Thank you also to my colleagues from the assessment office and performance office, as well as CAI. Thanks everyone. Have a great afternoon and stay safe.